Good afternoon, and welcome to the January 20th meeting of the New Jersey Bridge Authority. My name is Jim Sprout, Chairman. Vice Chairman Francis Basilio is to my left, Commissioner Rod Dressel, Commissioner Stan Lashua, Commissioner Roger Higgins. My right is Commissioner Joe Ramaglia, Commissioner Richard Jarenkine, our Director of Public Affairs, John Belushi, Counselor Gift Woodback, and our Executive Director, Joe Ruggiero. We have a couple of committee meetings prior to the full agenda of the board. So I'm going to defer to Commissioner Jarenkine for purposes of the governance meeting.
Thank you, Commissioner Chairman Sprout.
We have a governance committee meeting. I'd like to adopt the minutes of the December 16th meeting.
So moved.
So moved. Second. Roger?
Second.
Any discussion? If not, roll call. All in favor, say aye.
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 Second, review the annual Board of Commissioners evaluation survey. This is something new for us. It's a brief meeting to discuss the requirements of this evaluation. The Authority Budget Office has asked, under statutory authority, that every authority board conduct a self-evaluation of the board and its performance. The ABO provided a policy guideline memo, and we drafted a survey which was attached. Everyone had a copy for the last week regarding the survey. Has there any questions?
So, do we adopt it?
Well, we're going to adopt it, but we have any questions first? We're going to adopt it, then make a recommendation to the board, the full board. All right. Roger? So moved. Second.
Vince? Second.
Yep. Any other discussion? If not, roll call. All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
I just want to make a comment. John Belushi was, and I met for, I don't know, an hour or so, going through the questions provided by the health, them. And we customized it. It was John, and John did a great job of integrating everything. I just want to thank him for that.
Thank you.
Well, that's why we hired him, because he's such a good professional.
Yeah, there you go. All right, Mr. Chairman, as this is a function of the Governance Committee, I have the surveys prepared for the board members. I'll just pass them out. Mm-hmm. They're to be, you'll find an envelope that will return them to me. They are confidential, so please treat them, the only person that's going to see the results is myself. And what I will do is I will compile them together and present them as soon as I get them all back at the next Governance Committee meeting. Then we'll file them with the Authority Budget Office. The only thing that the Authority Budget Office will see is the compiled results. So that's the way they wanted it done, and we thought that that would be the best way to proceed.
Very good.
I don't have any other business for the Governance Committee.
Any other business? If not, motion to adjourn.
So Rogers, second.
Anyone will say aye?
Aye.
Aye. Chairman?
Adjourned. Thank you, Chairman. Also, now we defer to the Chairman of the Finance Committee, Rod Dressel, with his two members, Commissioner Jarenkine and Commissioner Ramaglia.
Okay. management and staff is busy looking at our finances of the Bridge Authority, it appears, so they're keeping the Finance Committee busy. So we're going to have another meeting here today to really selection of the financial advisor. But first, we need to adopt the minutes of the December 16th minutes meeting. Okay. We're all in favor. Say aye. We're
aye.
In favor. Okay. So that's it for the minutes. So, it's been brought to the Financial Committee's attention that management is interested in selection of a financial advisor. So at this point, they have done some homework on it, and so I think it's appropriate for Brian and maybe Joe to bring us up to speed on some of their research of selecting a financial advisor.
Okay. In November, we issued an RFP. We received seven responses in the month of December. We evaluated those responses based on cost and qualifications, specifically experience with tollers. Having eliminated the lowest cost proposer for not having substantial experience with tollers, we interviewed the next lowest cost proposers. After interviews, we confirmed where we feel that Acacia is the lowest, is the most qualified proposer. And if you look through the package past the billing schedule, you'll see part of the presentation they had given us in the interview where they've identified, of course, contingent upon market conditions, the possibility for a $1.2 million savings should we attempt to refund our existing debt. So we feel after doing the research and checking references and speaking with them that they would be a good fit for the authority.
What exactly are they? Do they do consultant on the investment?
They're a consultant that really helps us deal with the bond market. They not only go and sell us or present us, position us to like a Moody's or an S&P to make sure that we get a good rating based on how we make modifications or the entire bond issue. But they also give us some guidance on when to go and actually go out to the market, things of that nature. So they're more of a consultant that specializes in financing.
One of the things they're going to do is put together the prospectus that we need to disclose to the finance world, our financial condition. They certify, well, we actually do the certification, but they do an independent review and help put it together. So when that prospectus goes out to market, and the bondholders incur debt, buy our debt. It's an instrument we use to market ourselves. And they're helping review, as Brian said, with the interest rates being as low as they are currently for municipalities, they've done this preliminary assessment showing if we were to do an advanced refund now, our current debt is callable in 2012, so we can do what they call an advanced refund at this point. And be able to potentially save about $1.2 million over the next 6 years.
So. Hey, because when our existing bond?
2017.
Yeah, so it's time for us to
right.
Very soon.
Yeah. Well, in 2012, they'd be callable for the first time, and we're allowed a one-time advance refund as an authority on this bond before it's callable. So that's what we're looking at doing, take advantage of
it. As I recall, that bond was for somewhere around a little 4%, and now your anticipation, right. If this firm helps us negotiate something new, obviously we'll be able to hopefully buy a new bond for much less.
Yes.
Is this all part of the run-up to the issuance of the bonds for the new deck?
Yes. I mean, a lot of the groundwork we're laying here is going to go hand in hand also with our traffic consultants that we employed as we prepare the study work to do the presentation on a possible toll increase in 2012 and then running up to the 2013 indebtedness.
I tell you, I'm going back in history to Chris Cahill, who was a partner with Carl, did most of the work on the bond last time, right, Carl? And this is something that she was obviously in the interview, I understand here, and was strongly.
She was in the interview. She helped prepare the RFP.
Mm-hmm.
It was our recommendation that the authority hire a financial consultant, and this is the product of that process.
And then you will use them too going forward, because if we go for a new bond, that means you're going to come up with a book of the workings of the Bridge Authority.
Absolutely.
Which is an interesting book to read, I remember. But they'll help you with that too.
That's right. When we were interviewing this group, the head of the firm, this woman, she presented herself very well, and she sits on many commissions as a, for lack of a better word, of a trainer for other municipal governments and financial officials throughout the state. And she works a lot with the SEC. With what board was she on? The MRSC? I'm getting Municipal Review finance committee for the SEC, which basically she's telling municipalities how to be in compliance with these rules. So she comes well credentialed, and Brian called around for some references, and they checked that pretty well.
So now, okay, is there any other discussion, Joe?
I think overall it's a great move. I think we have to do it.
I mean, it's a cost savings initially if we don't proceed with the bonding in the future, but, you know, that's part of the whole process here. But I mentioned a while ago in the past that we should look at the bonds that we have existing, see if we can call them back and reissue them, because rates are much different than a lot of our bonds. So
I'm all in favor of it.
Motion to recommend to the board.
Second.
Okay, we're all in favor. Aye. Okay. We will recommend this to the board at the when you open up the other meeting.
Sure.
Okay. All right. So then, is there any other business for the finance committee? Good. All right. So motion to adjourn the finance committee.
Second.
I hear you, Joe. Okay. All fair and high. Okay, so that completes the finance meeting for January 2011. Good job.
Nice.
Thank you, Chairman. We're back in a regular meeting.
When you save it, yeah. Somebody has to buy the bond. Yeah. Which I'm sure they will.
First order of business is the approval of minutes from the previous month's meeting, December 16th.
Make a motion to accept the minutes.
Second.
All
favor. All right. We're going to go at this point out of order slightly. We're going to have Craig Perry, Director of Information Technology, come up and review his two proposals, which are towards the bottom of the first page.
Thank you. I ask you to please excuse the attire. I'm buried over in the command center, running cable and crawling under floors. So
another cross-saving measure. Oh, really? Yeah. Compliment, John.
Plus, you look thinner too, Greg.
Thank you. Can I dress like this, everyone? Okay, I have two items today. I've got our monthly port security monthly procurement report. The expenses for this past month were $6,800. This was basically connectors and cabling for the Bear Mountain Bridge project. Joe has asked me moving forward from here. This report will be turning into similar to what Bill does at Jobs and Progress Report, so we're covering more of the projects IT is currently working on. So we'll incorporate this into a larger report each month. The other item I have, last month you awarded the general EDP consultant to Dr. Ted Mankovic. At that time, there was no dollar amount associated with that contract. Once we had his rate approved, we then went back and had him assign numbers to the scope of work for the season, and attached is a task list for 2011 outlining the various projects that Dr. Mankovic will be working on, along with the number of hours he anticipates spending on each of those projects. The total estimate is for 690 hours, totaling $86,250. This is approximately $3,000 less than we spent on Dr. Mankovic last year. We're actually looking at a larger number of projects, and that being part of that being our staff has been, you know, coming up to speed on what Ted does and stepping in more and more each year to help assist with the types of Ted performs for us.
And he's been working in this capacity for over a decade.
Long before my time here. Yes, he's been here a good 12, 15 years. So he has a good handle on it. And the things we're doing. So I'd like to ask for your approval for the award of this dollar.
Hey, one question. Mm-hmm.
Certainly.
On the training, ongoing training for Jeremy Pratty,
mm-hmm.
What's so that the person can take over a lot of these duties?
Right. So, for example, we use a programming code called Perl Scripting, and Ted had been our sole source of Perl Scripting. Jeremy has been trained in Perl, and so he's now doing a lot of those programming tasks. And Jeremy's been taking over more and more of Ted's work as time goes on. And that does require a considerable amount of training, transfer of knowledge. Pink?
It's my favorite language, by the way.
Oh, great.
But I was going to ask about the night watch item. Over time, I know Joe has said that it costs us more to keep the bridge open overnight than it, some of the bridges overnight than it does to collect the tolls. And that it might, this is a not very much time, 30 hours seems is not very much time to do that kind of analysis and to, is this involving selecting a vendor, selecting options?
This is strictly analysis and coming up with a specification of what needs to be done to move to that system. So, you know, we've already identified systems that need to be put in place for remote administration of the facility during those hours, if you will. So, for example, video needs to be moved into the command center. We have to have control of the gates. We have to have a two-way communication path open to each of the lanes. So if you have a patron pull into a lane, he doesn't have Easy Pass, doesn't have a dollar, he's sitting there, the gate's down. You know, how do we address that? So part of the analysis is, you know, do you automate it so that after a amount of time, the gate opens up the person through? Does somebody in a operations center, you know, hit a button and say, hi, you know, we're from the operations center, how can we assist you? So his analysis will be what has to be put in place to make all this happen.
But not, this doesn't involve the cash collection machines or anything like that?
This would not be procurement of those machines, but it will be an analysis of how those machines would be incorporated into the existing system.
Our staff has gone down to New Jersey to look at a sample of technology, and it's pretty impressive. And we saw an AETM machine, and we saw different shapes of them, and they're pretty much customized any way we would want it to be, whether we want it, as Greg said, a video connection back and forth between the machine, or you know, option between credit card, cash, and whatever we need to do. So that's what we have to develop.
So on the any other questions, if not, on the resolution?
I'll move it.
Second?
Second.
All right. Very good. Thank you, gentlemen.
I have
two related items under administration, both dealing with the Easy Pass Interagency Group. The first one on the agenda is to authorize payment of the invoice for our annual assessment for our membership in the Interagency Group. As a small member agency, our dues is set at $17,500 annually. And that remains unchanged since we joined the group back in 1997. So we pay this bill every January, and with your authorization, we'll go ahead and pay that invoice.
It says $27,000.
That's you're on the second one.
Sorry.
Oh, it's the annual assessment here.
Fortunately, that's been the same for several years.
Yeah, it's always been the same. They haven't changed the dues assessment over the years.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. The second one is a special assessment. If you recall, about a year ago, I came to you and discussed the fact that the Executive Management Committee of the IAG, which I'm a member of, had voted to establish a one-time special assessment to deal with the procurement, the ongoing procurement that we're involved in right now to procure new equipment to replace the existing readers and Easy Pass tags that go in the vehicles, the antennas, everything that surrounds the technology. It's currently, the current vendor is Mark IV out of Canada. We put out an RFP back in 2008, March of 2008, the collective agencies, 23 agencies across 12 states. And we received a few proposals, and we shortlisted two potential proposers. And out of that, we went into a validation testing phase. And that's a very involved process that involves a third-party independent consultant to evaluate the equipment in a live environment or a simulated live environment. So we have two test sites that we began testing in mid-2009. We were using the Pennsylvania Turnpike in Harrisburg, and then we were also using a facility, which is an auto racetrack in Crofton, Maryland. And there are a couple of different types of testing that are going on that involve traditional toll plazas and also open road scenarios that currently exist in other agencies. And so Harrisburg was being used for one type of scenario, and Crofton is being used for another type where there's a little bit more room and high-speed opportunity. That validation testing is coming to a close. This spring we should be finished. We're done in Harrisburg. We're down in Crofton now. And the way the validation testing was articulated in the RFP was that each of the vendors would have to put up $2 million toward the testing phase, and the IAG would put up the remaining, would put up the balance. So when we were analyzing this a year ago, we realized that, you know, if we didn't want to deplete the reserves in the IAG operating, in their budget, we would need to have a special assessment to deal with our share, with the IAG's share of that validation testing. And so the resolution that was attached, the IAG resolution that we passed last February, was attached to your memo and resolution here. And you see that the small member agencies were assessed $27,500, and the larger agencies were assessed $55,000. And at the time, it was established that you could, that the agencies could so designate how they wanted to be billed for that. Some agencies wanted to include it in 2010 and fully pay it in 2010. Some wanted to spread it across a couple of years. At the time, John Sewell recommended that we defer the payment till first quarter of 2011, and every agency has to be paid up by the first quarter of 2011. So this is the point where we're at now. We need to pay. We've been invoiced for our share, which is due the end of February, and we're asking for your authorization to go ahead and pay that assessment. And we don't anticipate any additional assessment for this because we are so close to the end of the validation testing. It looks like we're going to be able to complete it with the funds that are available now, both from the two shortlisted vendors and from the IAG.
Any questions?
So what happens if someone doesn't fit their assessment? The rest of the group have to commit?
No, everybody's committed to pay. In fact, I think there were only a few agencies that waited until 2011.
The Thruway, case here?
We were one. The Thruway was another. So
I'll make a motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Now you're all familiar with our capital improvement program. We use contractors and consultants to fulfill our capital plans for maintaining our facilities, but we also perform capital improvements with our in-house maintenance staff as well. And of course, you've seen this memo broken down to 48 projects, my facility, and our new walkway over the Hudson. He's got a few projects as well. So there's a budget for each project. We track our labor, materials, equipment, and then if we successfully complete the work, we can then move costs from our operating budget to our capital, from our capital improvement revenue fund to our operating budget to reimburse those costs. So that's been helping in these leaner times. Any questions on the breakdown? Or?
Well, it looks like an ambitious plan.
Sometimes we don't finish everything we bite off, but we did pretty well last year. Got almost everything done.
I might just comment. Actually, you've only been doing a report on all this in-house work in the past, what, two or three years?
That's correct.
Right?
Yeah, we've always done a lot of this work. We just didn't take credit for it. And anything that we think lasts over 5 years has a legitimate capital improvement life. We're looking at now and tracking it instead of an operating cost.
We used to absorb all of these costs in the operating budget.
Correct.
And then, you know, when we started looking at the issues toward the refunding and these other things, we realized that we had quite a bit of operating that we could charge to capital. And so John Sewell recommended that we make this change.
And it's good to have it documented that it was accomplished, or was right. Worked on.
Well, at least we have a plan, and we do the as-built record keeping throughout the year, and then if there is money transferred, it's the actual costs for completed projects. So.
And it's also the cost avoidance of not having to
correct.
Go out the contract for
it. Yeah, it's a significant savings. Our consultants are involved in evaluating projects and making sure that we bite off something that we can't accomplish, and he calculates the cost savings independently, but I don't have that with me here. But
any questions on this?
Great. Thanks. Our second item is just the monthly jobs in progress. Not a whole lot going on in the world of painting down at Newburgh, but we expect to see everybody back in early March. We will be letting the project for the rehabilitation of the east approach here on the Hudson in the next month or so in anticipation of a full season of construction activity through Poughkeepsie in the area where we have four lanes, over Route 9, Rinaldi, the railroad tracks and what have you. So we'll try to resurface that, repair the joints, and you see a lot of patches out there now.
The new maintenance building there is working out fine.
Yep, the new maintenance building is a real pleasure to have to work on trucks in the winter. You can actually see what you're doing and get underneath them and lift them. So it's much better than working out in the yard.
And I think the executive director is going to plan a tour. Board members want to go through.
The command center.
Command center.
Yes, command center.
Right. It's right next door.
We're going to do right now. They got the floors all open because they're running cables, so that those are great. Yeah.
But that's nearly complete, and it's a little bit under budget. So it worked out for a fast track project. It worked out pretty well, budget wise.
Motion to accept the engineer's progress report.
Second.
All in favor?
First item for finance is the investment report. In the month of December, we made three investments, all treasury bill purchases with a slight increase in yield. The next item is the investment inventory. That reflects no balance in the debt service fund due to bond payments made at year end. And secondly, the maintenance reserve fund was invested to meet cash requirements for Q1 and Q2, so we're in good shape there. And lastly, in terms of the interest income and yield, it continues to be relatively flat at 1.01%.
It is what it is.
It is what it is.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
All in
favor. Okay. The next item was discussed last month at the audit committee. This document confirms that we agree to the $3,600 scope increase for the single audit related to the federal grant. So we're just asking the full board approve it before I sign it and send it back to Toski.
Motion to expand, adopt the resolution expanding the contract with Toski.
Second.
Okay.
I just one comment.
Follow up. We hired Toski up in Ulster County to do some various audit work for us up there. I just want to put that on the record. Mm-hmm. Should I or shouldn't I?
Well, I don't think it's a conflict, but it's not bad to disclose it.
Okay. Well, I disclosed it.
Okay. And you're able to vote. So all in favor?
Aye.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The next item is the selection of the financial advisor. basically, I think we discussed that in the Finance Committee. The only thing I wanted to add was, Joe, you had asked about what board the head of the project, Ms. White, sits on. It was the Municipal Securities Rulemaking Board, and I'm told from my friends at J.P. Morgan that the municipal securities market is self-regulated, and she actually sits as chair of the Rulemaking Board.
What's the name of the board again?
Municipal Securities Rulemaking Board.
Okay.
Will there be, and I don't want to get hung, I don't want us to get hung up on, but was there like a job description of any kind or what the project really was?
You know, this is more around them evaluating where we are and seeing what our opportunities are relative to the market. So obviously, if interest rates move significantly relative to our outstanding bonds, it's not worthwhile to refund, and then we would look solely at doing a new issue to go and support our capital projects. But they're going to do that evaluation for us and tell us as well about, you know, the bond covenant, any changes we might make, any things of that nature. So they're going to go in and reevaluate what we have in place now and tell us what it means if we were to make changes.
So basically give us options.
If
I can choose from those if we so choose.
So if we had excess cash available, we might choose not to issue new bonds for the full amount and pay off some of it now, right?
You know, we also discussed with them about the two funds that we do maintain cash in that we're required to under the existing bond covenant, and we were going to look into seeing what options we had available. Keeping in mind, of course, yields are just low right now for everybody, but yes, we were going to ask them about that as well.
I wondered if there was talk that if we wanted to invest in like throughway authority bonds or some other public authority that seem to be getting a better, paying a higher rate than what we're getting in our investments, whether or not that was a possibility. You guys said we might have to amend our bond covenants, or we have to look into whether or not you could do that.
I think our bond covenants do allow for that. Our investment guidelines are a little more stringent, but of course those are modifiable by the board. The bond covenant itself, I don't believe, prohibits that. But also keep in mind as well that even though they issued for a higher rate, there are the premium discount factors, that market rate of it is going to go and be impacted by our purchase price, not the face value on the bond.
One of the things we're going to look at is the current bond indenture, which we have reviewed with Chriselle a couple of days ago. And when we do the advance refund, this is an opportunity to look at those conditions that govern the way we do things and how our different funds are set up, and the net revenue factor of 1.75, which is considered extremely high. It might be a more reasonable net revenue number, which doesn't give us more money over the course of anything, but it demonstrates the long-term life of the current toll structure. And if we would go to the next toll structure under a new net revenue factor, that may take us beyond the next decade. So those are things that they're going to analyze for us. And that way, when we set up that new bond resolution, the board would be adopting that. We'll be operating maybe under a different set of rules than we have been.
And in our long-range plan, in our budget right now, we don't. Is there anything in there for the railroad or the walkway? Okay, so obviously they will have to be considered. Are they going to be scrutinizing that, too, to help make the difference?
I'm sorry, what do you mean scrutinizing?
Well, in other words, are they going to be taking that into part of their
Result? Yes, part of our
obviously, obviously, we've got another expense there that haven't had.
It's all considered part of our cost structure, yes.
And all that stuff has to go out. I mean, in a sense, what the legislature has done by passing the legislation and that directive is to take the walkway, it's kind of almost in conflict of our current bond indentures and current public authority law in a sense. So now this would give us an opportunity to put all that stuff out in the financial market in a publicly disclosed way, which it shouldn't impact any of our ratings or anything, but disclosure is better than none. So,
and we're doing, you know, we're going to do an engineering analysis of the walkway and the concept of this refunding and the result of that engineering analysis will probably come together at about the same time. So deciding how to do our disclosure will be based on information that's current and believable compared to some of the information that we have, so.
It might also identify a use for any excess funds that we did have for
early payoff.
Sure. I have some more to do.
On the resolution.
So moved.
Second.
All favor? Aye. Thank you.
Fred?
Good afternoon, gentlemen. My office gets to come to you every 5 years for what we call employee-required testing services. That's for our drug testing, for our physicals, both for toll collectors and laborers. So we went out to bid on November 4th. And again, this year, as in the past bid, we only had two bidders, again the same. So we sat down and we costed out the bid. We do it a little bit differently now. We have a procurement process procedure that we run through rather than just do a standard cost analysis. Initially, the workplace came out at $32,000 and emergency one came out at $28,000. Those were for the initial costs for services. The next thing that we as the authority have to take into consideration is getting our people to and from the facilities for the service. And to try to narrow this for you to make it simple, the workplace has a facility in Poughkeepsie and in Beacon. About 70% of our workforce rests between the Mid-Hudson Bridge, the operations center, and the IT department, and then, of course, our largest facility, the Newburgh Beacon Bridge, which happens to sit on the Beacon side. So there's virtually no cost for us to get our personnel back and forth between those facilities. And emergency one happens to sit in Kingston, so we do have a Kingston Bridge there, so there's no cost for that. But we sat down and did a matrix of running our people back and forth to both facilities. The final numbers come out to, if we were to go with emergency one, it would be about $44,000, and if we use the workplace, it comes out to $40,000. So when I ran this all through the procurement procedure process, we are recommending that we stay, again, with the workplace as our health care provider.
Neither one of these facilities have a mobile?
There's a mobile, but there's a cost then again to run the mobile. And the last time this was done, they approached it from that, and it was even a little bit more expensive to run the mobile down because then there's so much an hour while the mobile's en route, and it runs the cost up also. We just happen to be physically located here, and the workplace physically happens to have their facilities in Poughkeepsie and in Beacon.
We're just going a little further with Joe saying, including the mobile price, what's that price compared to the price that we see before us?
Pardon me?
What Joe said, if both of them had a mobile service that came down and physically stationed at one of the bridges, what would be the cost of that as part of their total cost? I mean, you have $44,000, $40,000 of transportation cost and time cost of employees.
Correct.
Right? That's also cost and mileage and everything else of that nature.
Correct. Now,
all right. So what's the offset of the cost of their maintenance, their temporary mobilization coming down to bridges versus our cost of sending people, and you sending people one at a time, or you sending people as a group?
No, the Bridge Authority, there's probably part of your answer. The Bridge Authority sends people on a rotational basis based on their years in service. So they won't send a mobile down for like what they call onesie-twosies. As when we do our annual review for their what we would describe as their annual review as we look at their performance review. So what happens is we don't send everybody at once for physicals on January 15th. It's in rotation when their time comes up. So they wouldn't send a mobile van down for one person or two persons or three persons. We've never done that. It's never been in our policy.
I think the question they had is, was there a cost difference? Did they give you a separate cost proposal for mobile to be included?
Well, there is a cost for mobile, but it wouldn't be in our, it's not advantageous for us to go in that direction, because we wouldn't have enough people at one time to utilize the mobile facility.
So we don't have enough critical mass of employees.
Correct.
To benefit from.
Correct.
And when you figured people traveling from the particular bridges to either workplace or emergency one, are you, they traveling individually, they, as a group, or?
Well, they're.
Now, this number of 44,000, this number of 40,000, is this calculated on each individual employee going up at a separate time, or as a?
Well, it doesn't matter if they are, it doesn't matter if they're separate or together, we're paying their hourly rate, so.
I understand, but the transportation cost is going to be consolidated if you have five people going versus one person going.
Well, I didn't even add that in. This is just the cost on a per-hour basis. If we send a laborer up, he's getting paid $20 an hour, roughly. So if it takes him a half an hour to go up and a half hour to go back, that's an additional, an hour of our payroll money.
Right. But you're not even counting.
I didn't even count into.
That we're borrowing that cost, correct?
Correct. That would, again, raise, again.
So that would increase.
Would increase it again, introspectively, the way this is. In other words, the numbers would come out even higher, but in about the same spread.
I was just going to say, this is just an incremental, it's $8,000 incremental from one proposal. The proposal, it's not $40,000 for the reimbursement. It's just, this is.
Correct.
Who's subject to the required testing? What are we discussing here?
This is for all the laborers go for physicals. All the toll collectors go for physicals. And we also contract for a return to work physical. And in that instance, for example, the workplace is at $300 and emergency ones at $450.
What's our motive in having physicals done on all the employees to see if they've got lead contamination or anything?
Well, we test for that also. That's also a separate test that gets done twice a year for lead testing. I mean, right. there's a worksheet that we have that lists all the required.
So your laborers,
right.
You want to make sure they're in condition for.
Correct. And there's also a DOT test. The drivers have to also take a test for the DOT.
What would your toll collectors be tested for?
They just go for a physical to make sure that they're fit to work.
What is that a common practice to have all employees?
Only full time.
Your compensation.
And when I say full time, it's full time for laborers and toll collectors.
I just wonder why you'd incur that expense.
It's been contractual all along, so unless we decide to do something different with a contract next year, you know, we could change it.
Well, what's your goal in having everyone tested for a physical but not in a physically demanding position?
Wayne, what's the history of toll collectors being tested? Do you know, or?
We only send the toll collector if we suspect that.
So it's not everyone.
During work, they don't routinely get.
Oh, okay.
And what kind of testing are you doing? Not just necessarily doing physicals. Are there specific tests that are?
Well,
the laborers get.
The laborers that do the climbing get a special.
Right.
During the duty type, hazardous physical.
Right.
Test their agility. The people that have commercial driver's licenses, which are all of our neighbors,
that's mandatory.
You don't get randomly tested.
And then, of course, when we return, if we're not on a disability, then on the maintenance side, that's pretty much.
And this covers a period starting January 1st of this year?
Correct. And it runs through December 31st. It's a five-year contract that we have the option to renew annually.
And has the previous contract expired?
It has expired, but in past years, for whatever reason, this always happens to come up in January instead of December.
Right, so maybe next time we just want to do it a little bit earlier. That's all. Any other questions? If not, on the resolution. So moved. Second.
Second.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Good job.
Long time.
Brief update, gentlemen.
As you know, we closed on the Walkway property on December 20th, and we did a ceremonial signing on the 21st. Golden prize of the event went quite well, and actually, public reaction was pretty decent. We continue to meet with State Parks and Friends of the Walkway Group to ensure a coordinated effort. Bill, as you mentioned, is supervising the engineering investigations, and he'll be developing a work plan after those reports are in. You have in front of you an event schedule for 2011. There's no special bridge anniversaries or other broad-based events that we're aware of, like the quadricentennial at this time, so the focus will be on the many community-oriented events that take place on and around the bridges. As always, our bridge personnel, both the toll collector staff and the maintenance staff, do a really good job of assisting organizations that have these events. We're pretty accommodating. They keep it safe, and the bridges are an important part of the communities up and down the river. Lastly, we're going to be expanding our internet web-based information. Shortly, we'll be adding an expanded section on doing business with NYSBA, publicizing the opportunities for minority and women-owned businesses, and adding a new section to help advertise our contracts and procurement opportunities. We'll be working across all the departments to provide that information on as wide a range of goods as we possibly can. While we don't do a great deal of these types of requests for proposals or bids, adding the information to the website will increase another resource for businesses to look at. It also meets one of the objectives of the expanded procurement policy that the board approved this past August. So I just wanted to apprise you that hopefully it'll ensure best practice and best price. Great. Any questions? That's where we are on that end.
Keep up the good work. This is with the Walkway Club, so thank you. We have the executive director company report. So not for lack of effort on your part, but no expenditures beyond.
No record of doing anything.
But we also have a companion group of other reports. I don't know if the board members have them in their packet. They don't require any action that I'm aware of.
Committee report was distributed last month.
Right. Yep. So the adoption of the committee report, we have a motion for that. Right. So the board not to look at the reports. Any comments or questions? There are three or four of them. If not, there's a resolution to adopt the report. Do I have that motion?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
And Trevor's motion.
Okay,
we'll do that. Come back out.
Yep.
All right, we'll turn to attorney client. Motion.
So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
on.
Okay, we're reconvening after a meeting with our attorney and attorney-client privilege, and we discussed, among other things, contracts specifically, and I want to offer a resolution relative to non-toll revenue. The board has a copy of the resolution, a motion.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Seeing no other business, motion adjourned.
Motion adjourned.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.